Okay, I am here on the shores of Lake Michigan visiting my friend and colleague, Ed Valauskas. Ed is a librarian and information scientist, and he is the founder of the online journal First Monday, which he created in 1996 at a time when we didn't have any online journals.
Very few.
So it's really a great pleasure to be here talking to Ed, and I thought I would just ask him some general questions about the future of libraries and information and where we might be under conditions of disruption. So Ed, what do you think?
Well, libraries are in an interesting position relative to technology, because technology has actually helped libraries flourish over the last 10, 20 years. It's actually been a huge boom in the use of libraries, how people interact with those institutions, in part because the availability of the internet has made individuals and organizations more aware how important libraries happen to be in finding information quickly, in finding accurate information quickly. You can find all sorts of information on the internet, but some of it is of not great utility, to be diplomatic. So libraries have become, in a sense, organizations that help you find verifiable, accurate, good information quickly. And I think in the future that dependency on libraries will grow, especially if there are issues in accessing technology and power in the future. So if we want to use some of the digital materials in the future that we access over the internet, some of those items, some of those documents might not be available because they have a disruption of some sort. Well, libraries have things in paper, you know, so I can read Nature, which I love reading every week. You can find the paper issue of
that.
Back to the future, yeah. Reading something on paper. Or they have digital works stored on media like compact disc. So these are versions of the Gutenberg Bible on a compact disc, and I have multiple copies of this. I once upon a time would give my students the Gutenberg Bible overnight to look at and play with. Not too many places where you could do that, but libraries have copies of these objects in this format, and you can check them out and use them. So libraries will become even more so centers for finding good information.
So do you think the physical library will continue to be important, given what you're saying about paper and so on?
Yeah, I think the physical library will continue to be important, if not even more important, because it will become this local center for information retrieval. The staff will have, and already have, but will even have more ability in being able to use those local resources in ingenious ways to help people solve different problems that they need to resolve.
So we'll still have librarians in these
libraries. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And in fact, librarians are actually doing quite well in this information economy. There's been a growing demand for libraries and librarians. And so back when the internet first appeared on the scene, in fact, when the World Wide Web first appeared on the scene in the early 1990s, there was much wringing of hands.
I remember
And people saying, oh, this is the death of libraries and the death of librarians. And I did quite well going around to my colleagues saying, that's not the case. People are with the internet are going to realize how important libraries and librarians are. And we just have to understand how this technology works. And many librarians, perhaps they didn't embrace my words, but caught on to that idea. And libraries and librarians have become quite important in this digital economy. And so librarians wind up working in libraries, but they also wind up working for technology companies like Yahoo or Google,
mm-hmm,
because
mm-hmm.
those companies recognize the importance of the skills that librarians have in finding and organizing information.
Mm-hmm. How about copyright, Ed? What do you think that will be like under conditions of disruption?
Copyright's an interesting concept because it's a relatively new concept. It's one that was invented in response to technology. So the first notions of copyright legally appeared in the 18th century before copyright was formalized into, say, British law. There were different kinds of agencies that governed the publication of books to prevent them from threatening the church or the state. These sorts of notions of copyright that we know today were emerged in the 18th and 19th century, and over time have grown to be more protective of corporate interests rather than individual interests. And so one of the interesting things that I see emerging, for instance, is that libraries now provide access to, say, the digital version of this journal, but they don't own the digital content. With some changes in copyright law, or in actual contractual law, a library could have this content in its collection digitally. And that, I think, would be very important, because if there were sort of cosmic events that disrupted power and disrupted technologies, you're going to need these institutions to have this local information available. You can't depend on the network to access the content of nature. And copyright is this way of, the way it was originally conceived was a temporary protection to intellectual property, to allow that person who created that work to enjoy some short-term economic benefits. And the original notion was that those benefits would occur over a short period of time, say a decade, and then the work would fall into public domain. And when you think about it, a healthy democracy depends on lots of information being in the public domain. But over time, the term of copyright has grown to the point where it's now on a geologic time scale, life of the author plus 70 years. And there are ways of manipulating that timetable so works just are protected under copyright for what seems to be forever. So we need to address these notions of copyright, the term of copyright, and we need to make it easier for institutions like libraries to have more digital content that they can have on hand, and to make it accessible locally and to make it available for any individual to deal with without worrying about Macmillan, who owns nature, saying how you can access this. That's encouraging because we're seeing the growth of open access journals growing at a much faster rate than traditional scholarly publishing.
Okay.
And so I'm heartened that this model is being adopted by more and more scholars and institutions. And this is a place, again, where libraries are playing an important role, because libraries have become publishers of these sorts of journals.
Mm-hmm.
First Monday is published essentially by the University of Illinois at Chicago, but also the University of Illinois at Chicago Library. So this institution has decided to support this model.
So this is another way in which libraries will continue to gain in importance.
And become not only distributors of information, but creators of information.
Yeah,
and producers.
Yeah.
And working with scholars to create more open information and make it more widely available, both on a global scale, but also on a local scale. And that's very important.
Yes. Okay, we had talked about the solar storm scenario. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, one has to think about what would be the sort of catastrophic event that would disrupt power and would disrupt computing. There was an paper that was published in Nature Communications not long ago this year about a solar event that occurred in which a large mass of charged particles erupted from the sun and went into space, essentially towards Earth. But luckily, Earth dodged that storm, dodged that bullet. This was in 2012. These storms can essentially overrun the protection that the Earth has. The Earth has a magnetic field that essentially absorbs the impact and deflects these charged particles that are coming from the sun. This 2012 storm was traveling at a rate of speed that in 18 and a half hours it would have traveled the 150 million kilometers from the sun to the Earth. So in 18 and a half hours, there's not much you can do in 18 and a half hours to get ready for one of these storms. We can't put up like some science fiction defense field. It's not going to work. Earth doesn't have like a Star Trek, you know, field to prevent this from happening. And so what would have happened had that storm actually hit the Earth because of its intensity? First of all, radio would have been disrupted. GPS devices would have been disrupted. Think about all the things that are dependent on GPS. Airplanes, yeah, ships, right. Automobiles, trains. So transportation would have been disrupted. Radio communications would have been disrupted. The second thing that would have been disrupted by the storm would have been all the various satellites that circle the Earth, because essentially their mechanisms would have been fried from these highly charged particles. And then the third thing that would have happened is that the storm was so powerful that it would have disrupted all the power supply in the world. There was an event like this that occurred in Canada in 1989, and it disrupted power supplies in Quebec for up to 9 hours before they were able to restore power. And this was this event in 1989 was not on the scale of the one we just dodged. So scientists predict that one of these events, there's a very strong likelihood one of these events could occur in the next few decades. And if that occurred, we have no way of, if that occurs, we have no way of dealing with the disruption to telecommunications, to information technologies, and to power supplies. My home is dependent on electricity to help keep the furnaces going. So if that storm struck in the winter, I would lose power and the pipes would freeze and I would have to be dependent on the fireplace to keep myself warm. I mean, so it would be very disruptive. Food would be spoiled depending on the time of year. You couldn't communicate because all the ways of communication would be broken down. And so that would cause this everyone to fall back to a very local kind of dependency. You couldn't really think about driving any place. You would have to get around by walking and or using a bicycle. You would have to forage for food. I would have to go to the lake and go catch my protein so I would have something to eat. And I would have to forage for berries and nuts in the forest around me. Which maybe would not be a bad thing. But we would also become very dependent on local sources of information. So my library, which is a little over a mile away, would become a very important institution to me to go to find things in paper or things in the sorts of technologies that I might be able to use. But I might not have access to the internet on sort of the scale that I know. And We might have a different kind of internet. We might have a local kind of internet.
If we were going to be prudent, we should definitely invest in libraries for many of the reasons that you've mentioned, it sounds like to me.
Libraries, I think, have always been a good investment, but I think if we're concerned about what might happen in the future, they will become even more important institutions as repositories for local information, local knowledge. And we need to maintain them, keep them strong, and keep them supplied with the kinds of people that can take advantage of these technologies.
So we need the people and the information.
Yeah, it's not they can't run by themselves. You need the kinds of trained people to help them work.
So if we were thinking ahead to the future, we would probably want to think even more about how to design libraries for the future. All right, well, good. Well, I'd like to thank you very much, Ed. This has been really interesting. And students, I want to encourage you to go to firstmonday.org.
Please.
There are a lot of great articles about the internet. Mm-hmm. That is what the topic of the journal is. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you'll find much of interest there. Okay, thanks again, Ed.
Thank you.